Hello friends, welcome to Word Encounter. Today our topic is Settle It, Part 2, Settle It. Before we pray, let us listen to the beautiful voices of the four-star triplets.
As Jesus battled the powers of darkness at Calvary, the plan of salvation became a reality for you and me. The hand of salvation moved closer to us, closer and closer as the blood oozed from his body. His salvation became the turning point in the lives of the human race. We have the chance of eternal life because Jesus stood in the gap for us. Then came the morning. Night turned into day. The stone was rolled away, and we have the power in Jesus.
They all walked away, nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now he was dead and gone. The garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail. How could a night be so long? Then came the morning. Night turned into day. Stone was rolled away. Hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won. For morning had come.
The star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine, and now it was done. They had taken her son, wasted before his time.
She knew it was true. She watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man. Oh, but deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again. Then came the morning. Night turned into day. Stone was rolled away. Hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won. For morning had come.
Thank you, Foster Triplets, for that beautiful, beautiful music. Let us bow our heads and pray. Father, we give you glory. We praise you. We worship you. There is none holy as you. There is none beside you. You are King of kings and Lord of lords. And so, Lord, help us now and bless us. And take all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Settle it. If you fail to allow God to help you settle your weaknesses, these weaknesses will eventually unsettle you. And it might mean some real disaster to your soul. It might mean the loss of eternal life. And sometimes you might be saved, but some great loss would really have come to you. Samson comes to mind. Samson would not settle his weaknesses. He had weakness for women. He valued his relationship with a woman than his covenant with God at the point in time. And he would not settle it. If you read the story of Samson in Judges, you will find out that Samson prayed all his life. I don't want to believe it's only twice, but the Bible recorded it that he prayed twice. And he would always pray when he was in trouble. He would always pray only when he was in trouble. We don't have to wait until we are in trouble before we pray. We have to develop a relationship with God. We have to meditate on His Word and allow His Word to speak to us, to come into our heart and our spirit. But Samson prayed only when he had fought and he was very thirsty. And then he prayed and said, God, give me water. And God helped him. The second time he prayed was when he was to die with his enemies. We need to pray more. We need to study more of the Word of God and allow it to settle our weaknesses, to strengthen us. There are things we need to settle. For some people, it is anger. For others, it will be pride. For some others, it will be materialism. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. But God is saying we have to settle things. Judas is another person. Judas loved position. He loved money. He loved power. And Jesus wanted him to settle it. Jesus does not want anyone to perish. And so, when Jesus called the 12, that's what the Bible says. He said he called 12. So he must have called Judas too. The Bible says he called and ordained 12. And so he loved Judas. And there were times he had to rebuke him in a way that the others didn't know what he was saying. Just to make him not to be embarrassed. And when he was washing the feet of the disciples, he washed that of Judas. He was washing his feet. He wanted to wash his heart along. But Judas would not give his heart to Jesus Christ. And then you know how he ended up. The love of money. And those times Jesus was rebuking him, he wouldn't take it very seriously. He would even have some resentment for Jesus to the extent that he would betray his Lord. We need to be careful with our weaknesses. The name we will focus on today very, very well is Uzziah. Uzziah was a king of the southern kingdom. You know, when Solomon sinned against the Lord and his son Rehoboam could not put the kingdom together, God split the kingdom, giving 10 kingdoms to Jeroboam, who ruled in the north, and then two to left the two for the house of David. So Uzziah was ruling the southern kingdom, and he was the 10th person to sit upon the throne of David after Solomon, the 10th guy. Let's read a little bit about him. 2 Chronicles chapter 26, beginning from verse 1, we read, it says, then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in the room of his father Amaziah. Verse 3, 16 years old was Uzziah when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jecoliah of Jerusalem. Let's read verses 4 and 5. gives us more details about this guy. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah did. And he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. I like that. He had understanding in the visions of God. We need to have understanding in the visions of God, in the books of Daniel and Revelation. But that's the one we're talking about today. Let's continue to read. It says, and as long as he sought the Lord, that's Uzziah, as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. Wow. If you seek God in your life, you will prosper. What an amazing guy. He enjoyed power, privilege, and wealth. You know, when you enjoy privilege, that is something that is not commonly accessible to other people. He enjoyed it all. He had a great start. You know, he ruled the southern kingdom, Judah, for 52 years. 52 years. He was a co-regent with his father. In other words, he ruled with his father for some time. Actually, for 23 years, from when he was 16. His father had ruled 6 years before, and he ruled alone for 29 years. If you put all of that together, he ruled for 52 long years, more than half a century. He ruled. What a time. And then let us look at his accomplishments. This guy had almost everything going for him. God was with him. God prospered him. He did great things. Let us read 2 Chronicles 26. We will read verse 2 and then we will read verse 6 to 15. We need to read these verses to really get what is happening. I'm going to be putting some commentaries into the verses as we read on. Okay, so let's begin. Verse 2, the Bible says, he built Elot and restored it to Judah after that the king slept with his father. After the death of his father, he built the city of Elot. Elot was actually a key coastal city that was a strategic naval base and also a copper smelting center of the times. It goes on, verse 6, let us read. Verse 6, and he went forth and warred against the Philistines and break down the wall of Gath and the wall of Jabneh and the wall of Ashdod and built cities about Ashdod and among the Philistines. Wow. So he was conquering cities and rebuilding them. Wonderful. Okay. And then he went forth and defeated the longtime enemies of Israel. The longtime enemies. These guys have been giving problems to Israel, but he defeated them. Let's read verses 7 and 8. It says, and God helped him against the Philistines and against the Arabians that dwell in Gobal, and the Mehunims and the Ammonites gave gifts to Uzziah, and his name spread abroad even to the entering in of Egypt, and he strengthened himself exceedingly. That's not the end. It goes on. He decided to make huge constructions in the capital city. He made huge constructions in the capital city. The man qualifies for what we today will call a visionary and a builder. Wow, a visionary and a builder indeed. He had a great start. He was pulling these things off, these achievements. So let us read. And the Bible tells us that, verse 9, Uzziah built towers in Jerusalem at the corner gate and at the valley gate and at the turning of the wall and fortified them. Wow. And then he went on and built fortresses. He built fortresses outside the capital city to protect his vast holdings of livestock. Vast holdings of livestock. And he also undertook a vast agricultural project to feed his people. This guy was amazing. Let's read verse 10. That's what we are told there. It says, also he built towers in the desert and digged many wells, for he had much cattle, both in the low country and in the plains, husbandmen also, and vine dressers in the mountains and in camel. and he loved husbandry. Wow. So he was a great, great guy. He was a great guy. And then he went on and organized one of the most powerful military force ever in Israel, with the most advanced weapons of and state-of-the-art art technology. Let's read from verse 11 to 14. The Bible says, "Moreover, Uzziah had an host of fighting men that went out to war by bands, according to the number of their accounts by the hand of Jael the scribe and Maaseiah the ruler, under the hand of Hananiah, one of the king's captains. The whole number of the chief of the fathers of the mighty men of valor were 2,600, and under their hand was an army, 300,000 and 7,500, that made war with mighty power to help the king against the enemy." And then in verse 14, we read, "And Uzziah prepared for them throughout all the hosts shields and spears and helmets and habergeons and bows and slings to cast stones." So this guy qualifies as somebody we would call a super achiever or an entrepreneur, if you will. So he was having it. He had it going for himself, and he was helped by God because he sought God. But something happened. If we read verse 15, we'll see a word that shows a turn in the events of his life. Verse 15, it says, "And he made in Jerusalem engines invented by cunning men to be on the towers and upon the bulwarks, to shoot arrows and great stones the widow, and his name spread far abroad, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong." You know, in some other version, that word "till" is actually "until." You know, when you see that word "until," it shows that there seems to be a turn in events. Something is going to happen. You know something is about to happen until, you know. So, and this actually in his midlife, something happened to him from the inside, from the heart, that made him to begin to fall. According to Sifara, there were three reasons why Uzziah, three things that he couldn't handle, three reasons, you know, that made him to fall. Three reasons why Uzziah fell. Number one, he said he was putting more attention on the external than the eternal. Have you seen people do that? They care so much about their skin. They will go all the way, you know, to have money, to make sure that their skin, you know, is beautiful. They care more about their skin than their hearts. They care so much about their clothes. They want to deck them, their bodies, their poor bodies that will rot in the grave, than decking their hearts with the precious character of Jesus, a meek and a quiet spirit. So Uzziah cared more about the externals than the eternal. Number two, which is a follow-up, a natural logical follow-up of number one, is that his character did not keep pace with his achievements. His character did not keep pace. You know, God has blessed us so much. Sometimes God, you know, bless you with Christian parents. You are born in a home where Jesus is praised and talked about and worshipped. That is a very, very powerful privilege. But you do not care really about that. You care more about worldly achievements than building your character for eternity. We're going to take only characters out of this world. Your fat bank accounts, your buildings, your cars, and so on and so forth. You're not going to take any of these things out of this world into the next. These things are good as long as they serve their purpose. But we don't take them out of this world into the next. The only thing that we take out of this world into the next is our character. And God wants us to actually, if there is an Achilles heel, if there is a weakness in us, God wants us to, with Him, settle this. But Uzziah failed in this. Number three, Uzziah was tripped by his success. You know, success, somebody said that success is like ice. When you are walking on ice, it can be, it's very cool, very smooth, very beautiful, but it can be slippery. It can be very, very slippery. Not many people can handle success. Not many people can handle wealth. Not many people can handle privilege. And Uzziah happened to be one of such. Okay? So it got into his head and he couldn't handle it. And it resulted into one big word, which is called pride. Pride. What is pride? Well, it's difficult to define pride. But pride has some symptoms that we need to talk about today. One is arrogance. When you are becoming proud, you know, you can be poor and be proud. And that's even worse. You can be poor, you can be ignorant and be proud. It shows up in arrogance. It shows up when you don't want to learn. It shows up when you don't want to lean on God. And another symptom of pride is lack of accountability. That's when pride really begins to grow. You feel that you are no longer accountable to anyone. You feel you don't have to explain anything to anyone. Have you come to that point where you are called to account for how you spend the money and you say, I'm not responsible to you. And you have been elected, or maybe, I don't know how you got into power, by these people, and you are saying you're not accountable to them. That is a very strong symptom of pride. And that's exactly what happened to Uzziah. Let's talk about the first one. Let's read and see how the first symptom of pride. He couldn't deal with pride. He couldn't settle it. He did not agree. He did not allow God to deal with the issue of pride. How do we deal with the issue of pride? Number one, we do not have anything that has not been given us from God, whether it is privilege, power or wealth, whether it is talent or it is knowledge or something. Everything we have today is given to us by God. That alone should humble us. If we meditate on the word of God and the life of Jesus, there is no way we can be proud, because when we behold the King of Glory upon the cross, when we see that the Prince of Glory, when he was born, the Bible says there was no inn for him, and he was born in a cattle shed. When I begin to reason these things, I said, Lord, help me. And we all need to settle this issue called pride in our life. It's not only wealthy people that can be proud. So one of the symptoms we said is arrogance. Let us see how it played out in the life of Uzziah. The Bible says in verse 16 of 2 Chronicles 26, let us read, the Bible says, but when he was strong, that is until he was strong, when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction, for he transgressed against the Lord his God and went into the temple of the Lord to burn incense upon the altar of incense. In other words, he decided to perform a duty that was not divinely ascribed to him. God has said that only the sons of Aaron, the priests, could do that function. But we are told that in the surrounding nations, the kings are very powerful. They control both the church and the state. They control both. The church is the sanctuary work. The state is the throne. So God wanted the king to be on the throne. He should not control the worship. But the king wanted to bring the worship, the state, and the church together. And so he wanted to behave like the other king. So he took the censer and went into the many people, even in America, the so-called free country, saying that church and state can be together again. Each time church and state comes together, the result is always persecution for dissenters. But God wants the church to operate differently from the state, and they should not be mixed together. False religion after the time of the cross would always want to merge the church and the state. They want to rule a religious power that wants to rule the state, or the state wants to rule the church. That was what was happening in the days of Adolf Hitler, when he was controlling, when Germany was the state. The church was a state-controlled church. It was a state church system. And it's happening in different places even today. And it's coming to America once again. And it's going to be a bloody time. So let's go back to Uzziah. So he was not supposed to be doing that. The pagan kings were doing that. But he wanted to be like them. And he ignored the word of the Lord. And that's what pride does. Pride makes you want to do things your own way, apart from what divinity has said. That's pride. That is what's called pride of opinion. God's word says the seventh day is the Sabbath, and somebody says, no, not the seventh day, the first day. And if you agree with that, that's pride of opinion. God said that he made them from the beginning male and female, but you say there's nothing like that. There is no distinction. A man can become a woman and all of that. Even in America today, there is that confusion going on, to the extent that somebody, the woman that was to be sworn in as the judge, was asked to define what a woman is. He said, I cannot define that. I cannot define that in the United States of America. But she must be referred to as a woman, the first black woman to become a chief judge. You know, so we are getting confused when we veer away from the word of God. And that was what was happening to Uzziah. So let us continue to read. You know, it's very, very important to know, when you begin to accept or demand things that may not be necessary for you, arrogance is on the way. According to Steve Farrar, he would say in his book, Finishing Strong, page 115, he would say that arrogance is beginning to creep into your life, quote, when you begin to expect the privilege and even demand for it, and find yourself getting upset when it is not there. You know, it's very, very, very terrible thing. And it leads to destruction. It says, pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. And that was what was happening to Uzziah. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18. The second symptom of pride is lack of accountability. And that was playing out also in the life of Uzziah. Let us continue to read verse 17 of 2 Chronicles 26. It says, and Azariah the priest, that is, as they saw him go into the temple, as they saw him take up his censer, moving into the temple, as they saw that was what was happening, Azariah the priest went in after him, and with him, fourscore priests of the Lord, that were valiant men, this strong priest, fourscore, 80 men, rushed after him into the temple to withstand him, to say, no. Let's read it in verse 18. Lack of accountability. Accountability when this is happening to you, when you lack accountability, you don't want to explain the reasons for your actions. You don't want to explain. You feel that you are beyond explanation. You feel that you are not responsible to those you are leading. You feel that nobody should talk to you. And then some gullible people would even interpret it. They would come to you and say that you are the anointed and nobody should talk to you. Anybody that talks to you is actually touching the anointed of the Lord. Such gullibility, especially in Africa. Terrible. So we read verse 18 and the Bible says, "And they withstood Uzziah the king and said unto him, It pertaineth not unto thee, Uzziah, to burn incense unto the Lord, but to the priests, the sons of Aaron, that are consecrated to burn incense." Here they were reasoning with him. They were reasoning with the king. But now he lacked accountability. He's arrogant, and then he lacked accountability. The two symptoms of pride. He lacked accountability. And the Bible says that they told him to go out of the sanctuary. "For thou hast transgressed, neither shall it be for thine honor from the Lord God." They were telling him, but you know, when you are talking to a proud person, they have to withstand him. They have to go and confront him, if you please, openly now, because he was doing something that was open. If what he was doing was in secret, they would meet him in secret. Secret sins, secret rebuke. But open sins, open rebuke. And so they were reasoning with him, but he would not listen. He became angry. That's what arrogance does. That's what lack of accountability, which is pride. So in verse 19 we read, "And Uzziah was wroth," in other words, he was angry, "and had a censer in his hand to burn incense. And while he was wroth with the priests, the leprosy even rose upon his forehead before the priests in the house of the Lord from beside the incense of the altar." What a tragedy. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Leprosy broke out of his forehead, and that remained with him until the day he died. You know, you and I don't know what weakness you have. You may be a leader. Some of our weakness is simply lack of courage to do the right thing. Lack of courage. I read a book of recent, you know, published in 2017, I think, by Nancy Cohen. Nancy Cohen is a historian with the Harvard Business School. Powerful book. Powerful stuff, you know. In the book, she recounted the story of five leaders who made up their mind in challenging circumstances. They made up their mind to settle it. Some of these leaders were, they had challenges of health, challenges as rulers of nations. For instance, Ernest Shackleton was an explorer. His challenge was to bring his team home alive. Great leader. Abraham Lincoln's challenge was to save a nation and transform it. Save America together and transform it so that it will not continue to be a place of slavery. And you know, the Civil War was fought largely over the issue of slaves. And Abraham Lincoln, at that time, he was losing the war. If he won the war, slavery would come to an end. But if he lost, and so at the point in time, he was very, very depressed in the White House. Depressed man, he was attacked, vilified. Some people said he was a noob, he was not smart enough, and all of that. In those times, thousands of people were dying in the war. Tens of thousands were dying. And people were saying, stop the war. He knew if he ended the war that way, slavery would continue. And then he made a decision. He settled it. Some cowards cannot do that. And that was Abraham Lincoln. And then he talked about Frederick Douglass' challenge, which was to end slavery forever. And then he talked about Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who resisted Nazi evil in his time. He was a pastor, died at the age of 39, but before that time, he could not be silent. He could not be silent. You see, all of these guys, at one time or the other, they had what they feared, but they decided to settle it in their hearts to move ahead. They settled it in their heart to do what was right. Dietrich Bonhoeffer decided to resist Nazi evil, to resist Adolf Hitler. Many people were afraid. Many pastors of his time could not speak against the evil of the time. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer decided that he was going to speak. Another person the book talked about was Rachel Carson. Rachel Carson, her challenge was to protect the earth and its creatures. So she wrote a book, Silver Spring. It was an environmental issue about DDT, a chemical they were spraying, a pesticide or something, but that was very, very dangerous to other creatures and man. And she wrote that book 60 years ago, but that book formed the foundation of all the environmental movement of our time, to the time we now talk about climate change and all of the rest. Powerful woman who battled with illness and cancer, battled with all the chemical companies, insecticide companies of the day that would be able to lobby government. She battled with naysayers and she conquered. Well, let me read what Dietrich Bonhoeffer said. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his book, I think, The Cost of Discipleship, you know, he left us with this powerful word. He said, when Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, German pastor who resisted Nazi evil. The evil of our time, that we have politicians in our time who call themselves Christians, but they cannot speak against the evil. They love their position, their self-aggrandizement. They love their money more than their people. This is really, really evil. And people are perishing by the day in different African countries because of such evil politicians. Now, there comes a time when you must settle it in your heart. You must cross the Rubicon and you must decide. Let me show you what Dietrich Bonhoeffer said as we find it in the book of Nassim Cohen, Forged in Crisis, page 309. We read, it is time, Bonhoeffer said, for a final break with our theologically grounded reserve about whatever is being done by the state, which really only comes down to fear. Fear is what holds many people. They never come to deal with it. They never come to settle it with God, for God had not given us the spirit of fear. Bonhoeffer continued in his quote, and then now he quotes the Bible. He says, speak out for those who cannot speak, who in the church today still remembers that this is the very least the Bible asks of us in such times as these. Bonhoeffer is telling us that we must cross the Rubicon. We must get to the point where fear no longer holds us from doing the right thing. And God is calling us today. God wants us to do the right thing. He wants us to know that He alone is our God, and He is the one who wants us to prosper and to stand for what is right. We gotta deal with stuff today. We gotta deal, and we gotta settle issues. You have to settle the issue of health. You have to decide whether you're going to live strong and work for God and those whom you loved and God's children all over the world. Or you're going to allow appetite to destroy you. Appetite, what people put into their mouth, is destroying millions upon millions of people today. Lifestyle diseases like diabetes, like cancer, like stroke, heart disease, number one. These diseases, you know, what people are eating are forming plaques in their heart, atherosclerosis, and people are dying by the thousands because of a simple issue of appetite. Appetite is actually a strong issue for many people. Many people would rather die than eat right. They are slaves to appetite and they refuse to deal with it. Refusing to deal with obesity, refusing to find time to exercise, and then spiritually refusing to come to Jesus to allow His Word to have a place in your heart. When you refuse to settle it, to settle these spiritual issues, these health issues, these moral issues of money and of pride, if you refuse to settle them, they in turn will unsettle you. And you, according to Stifara, will not finish strong. God wants you to finish well. He doesn't want you to be like Samson, like Judas, like Uzziah. Yes, He doesn't want pride to stop you. I want to read something to you. You know, a lot of people might be telling you the wrong thing. You know, somebody has said it, that if we must do what is right, we cannot be listening to naysayers. All of the five leaders we talked about today in Nancy Cohen's book, they had people who told them that it cannot be done. People who must have told Lincoln that he could not have won the war, and he could not have signed the proclamation. People must have told Nancy that what she was saying was nonsense. But we gotta have the courage. We need to have the courage to say no to naysayers. And God is calling us today and He's telling us what we should do. I have one last quote for you from the Spirit of Prophecy. Testimonies, Volume 4, page 543, paragraph 4. Let us read it together. Ellen White says, true Christian character should be marked by firmness of purpose. True Christian character should be marked by firmness of purpose and indomitable determination, which cannot be molded or subdued by earth or hell. He who is not blind to the attraction of worldly honor, indifferent to threats, and unmoved by allurements, will be all unexpectedly to himself overthrown by Satan's devices. In other words, if you cannot have a firm purpose, if you cannot stand, if you cannot resolve the issue of fear, if you cannot resolve the issue of health, if you cannot resolve and stand and settle with God in God's power, the issue of pride and the issue of immorality, the issue of what you eat and drink, if you cannot really come to Jesus today and let Him give you the power to settle these things, to be an overcomer, you will be overthrown by Satan's devices. You will be unsettled and you will not finish strong. God is calling you today and He's saying, my daughter, my son, I want you to finish well. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you today. We worship you like never before. We praise you and we pray that you be with us. Bless us today and help us. Be our God and be our guide and take all the glory. Lord, help your son today who is struggling with the issue of fear. And because of that, he's siding with the wrong. And the issue of selfishness is destroying someone today. Selfishness is not allowing somebody who's watching now to have, Lord, what it takes to be your servant, to be a channel to bless the world. Selfishness, hoarding of wealth. Lord, I pray today that you will help us to settle this thing so that selfishness will not destroy us like Ananias and Sapphira. Be with us today and bless us. As we encounter you in your word, may we never be the same. May you settle us. May you help us to be overcomers and to reflect the character of Christ more perfectly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen, friends. God bless you and may His face continue to shine upon you in Jesus' name. Amen.